With the 1,000 swimming corpses of the German crew of the destroyer Blücher in the freezing cold water of Oslofjord, the invasion of Norway revealed itself to be far more problematic than Hitler or most of the general staff had anticipated. The invasion of Norway itself, the fight of the undergunned Norwegian troops and the disorganized English infantry has been getting a revival recently. The military actions, while interesting, are only an extremely minor part of the scenario though. The far longer one was the occupation of Norway, which opposed to Belorussia, France or Netherlands, was never freed until the actual surrender of the German armed forces in 1945. The occupation of Poland, Russia and France are mentioned and appropriated at every possible moment of World War II history, mostly because of their brutality. But these occupations only show parts of a grander picture and were very different from Norway. Norway was not supposed to be enslaved, like for example the Slavs, but integrated into some vague notion of a pan-Germanic federation. The Nazis felt a certain sense of sympathy for Norway, which they considered the Urheimat and the origin of the Indo-Europeans, and therefore all Germanic peoples. This might seem similar to the occupation of Netherlands, which I also made a video on and which I can recommend watching before. But the Dutch were far closer to the Germans than the Norwegians were. Pan-German, or in German, Altdeutsche Rhetorik, was always present in the Nazi propaganda since the start of the party. Hitler himself only blames the distance the Dutch had to the Germans on the 30 Years' War. The same cannot be said about the North Germanic peoples. The occupation of Norway, opposed to the Netherlands, did not take very long to become an absolute chaos fest, and we will therefore explore how it became chaotic, why the Nazis wanted to befriend the Norwegians, how they tried, how it worked out, and how it in the end failed. The German-Norwegian connection is on the first look rather convoluted, but easy to explain. The research of the time believed still in the old theory that the Indo-Europeans started in modern-day Denmark and Norway, and not like it is today known, in the Eurasian steppe. Therefore, Norway was not only seen as a fellow Germanic people, just more north, but as something that the Nazis called Urheimat, or also called, in English, the original home of Germanic people, and therefore all Indo-European, or the more antiquated term, Indo-Aryan cultures. Going in such depths would make some viewers believe that people like Himmler would be very interested in Norway, but this was not the case. To give evidence for that, we have to introduce an important character in the story. Vidkun Quisling was born in 1887 into a bureaucratic and political family, got into right-wing politics through farmers' parties and made the first Norwegian fascist party named Nasjonal Samling in 1933. Back then he avoided showing a direct connection to National Socialism or Fascism and claimed it was its own Norwegian movement, but already in the early 30s he tried to make connections to fascist movements across the world. The stereotype of the Nazis would imply that they would be keen on supporting a fellow fascist from the Urheimat, but not even the most esoteric of the Nazis particularly cared about Quisling when he visited Berlin. Not even Himmler was willing to arrange a meeting when Quisling tried to set one up. Quisling, disappointed in this, returned to Norway to a largely unsuccessful political life. Norway at the time, quite similar to the Netherlands, was a rather peaceful country, the politics of the nation being split on the Farmers' Party, the Conservative Party, and a very minor left-wing party, with an utterly irrelevant Communist Party. Therefore, giving very little conflict or spice of politics that fringe ideologies like Quisling's needed to succeed. 3 years later, the first contacts were made with Alfred Rosenberg, but those were so sparse and so limited, they barely could give Quisling any hope. With the heating up of the European theater, this changed radically because of two branches of the state. The Navy was interested in Norway since 1929, where a book was released describing the issues of the Kriegsmarine in the First World War and how essential Norway was in protecting the North Sea. Kriegsadmiral Erik Reeder therefore was interested in making connections to Norway as soon as the war broke out. Meanwhile, Alfred Rosenberg, head of the Foreign Ministry of the National Socialist Party, not to be confused with the Foreign Diplomatic Office of the actual state, led by Ribbentrop, had to justify his department's existence. He saw Quisling as a potential tool to first of all uphold his relevance and also to give an entry to influence the Norwegian political system. In 1936, both Rede and Rosenberg organized a meeting on the 11th of December 1939. Quisling managed, with his romanticism, charm and ability, to claim way bigger numbers of support than there were in reality, and therefore convinced both Rede and Rosenberg that he was qualified to meet Hitler. After Rosenberg gave Quisling a lesson on the quote-unquote Germanic idea, the meeting could begin. There is no transcript of the first meeting between Hitler and Quisling, or even general reports, but that this conversation had an effect is undeniable. Few days after this talk, Hitler told the OKW to begin developing a plan of military action against Norway. Quisling also seemed to have achieved some ideological influence on Hitler, maybe because of Rosenberg's preparation. On the 20th of December, 9 days after the meeting, Hitler writes in a guest book, "For the year of fighting for the Germanic Reich." This meeting already gave Quisling the reputation of being a traitor in the national politics of Norway. In the planning of Studio Nord, which would later become Operation Weserübung, the Wehrmacht from the start tried to avoid any ideological experiments in Norway and wanted to avoid problems like in Poland. Their strategy to achieve this was treating Denmark and Norway the same. Both nations were put together for their plans, and because Denmark had no Quisling, any inclusion of him or his party could be avoided by the military. On the 10th of April, Hitler gave his propaganda orders to Goebbels for Norway.
Kein Protektorat, sondern ein Bündnis. Einheitlichkeit der Außen-, Wirtschafts- und Zollpolitik. Wir bekommen als Eigentum wichtigste militärische Stützpunkte, übernehmen militärischen Schutz und die beiden Staaten verzichten auf jede Wehrmacht. Ziel: Nordgermanischer Staatenbund.
The early talks with Quisling and general ideological directions hinted at a Germanic federation with Norway, opposed to a direct annexation like it was the plan in the Netherlands. The military had no interest in this though and planned to simply collaborate with the governments as viable as possible. They expected Norway to function exactly like Denmark, instant surrender and then leaving them largely sovereign besides foreign policy. But the reality looked different. Meanwhile, the Danish king told his troops to surrender after 6 hours, the Norwegians fired on the German destroyer Blücher, and with 1,000 dead Germans in Oslofjord, the Norwegian king decided to resist. This marks two events, extremely significant to the invasion. First, the diplomacy of Dr. Kurt Breuer and the Vidkun Quisling Oslo government. Kurt Breuer's strategy was trying to appeal to both the king and the current ruling parties. This strategy was heavily hindered though because Quisling, who as soon as the invasion started, announced his own takeover of the government and set up his headquarters in Oslo. On the 9th of April, this was such a surprise to everyone that when the Wehrmacht arrived in Oslo, they planned to arrest Quisling. The many generals did not even know who he was. With the early confusion out of the way and some calls to Berlin, the government building was confiscated by the Wehrmacht and given over to Quisling. Hitler did not approve of Quisling's own government, but did insist at this point on him being included in Breuer's talks with the Norwegian king and government. Quisling was on large, undeniably disliked by the population, and the king was aware of this fact. He was in no way ready to sign a treaty with the Germans if Quisling had to be included in his government after the conflict. A similar treaty as in Denmark was therefore realistic if Quisling was just excluded, but this did not happen. Hitler kept insisting on Quisling in the early discussions. Why insist on Quisling though? The reasons for this cannot be 100% determined, but it is very likely that Hitler, influenced by Rosenberg, desired ideological influence in Norway. If a similar conclusion was reached as in Denmark, Norway would have stayed independent internally without any German ideological influence that Hitler so desired. This hard approach to Quisling changed radically though, with the deterioration of the situation, and the landing of the Allies, which caused Hitler great mood swings. Even though Hitler stated on 9th of April, if Rosenberg's diary is to be trusted,
er lacht übers ganze Gesicht. Nun kann ja Quisling seine Regierung bilden. Wir drückten die Hoffnung aus, dass die geflüchtete Regierung nicht etwa Quisling verschleppt habe.
Only 3 days later he said to Quisling's right-hand man Hagelin,
es sei ihm nun egal, wer drüben regiere.
The fact that Hitler thought Quisling was even relevant enough to be kidnapped shows how strongly he was deceived by his relevance. With Hitler's lack of interest, diplomat Breuer could therefore finally force Quisling to back down to break through on the diplomatic stalemate. This failed, however. At this point, the 15th of April, the king had enough confidence by the Allies to reject any political cooperation with the Third Reich. The only thing Breuer could achieve was an administration council that was responsible to simply keep the basic infrastructure going. Breuer therefore failed on both levels. He failed to get Quisling a certain position, going as far as to humiliate him by forcing him to surrender his own government, while also not achieving a Danish solution. That this was the end of his career is self-explanatory. With all diplomatic attempts failing, Hitler knew it was time to plan for a Reichskommissariat. On the 19th of April, the Gauleiter of Essen was called to Berlin to become the Reichskommissar of Norway. This was a surprising choice. He was a friend of Göring, renowned for his economic skills. His personality was infamous though.
Als ich einem Gauleiter einmal sagte, ich hätte selten so einen unaufrichtigen Menschen kennengelernt wie seinen Kollegen Terboven, erhielt ich die trockene Antwort, dafür ist er ja bei uns bekannt.
Meanwhile, Otto Sass Inquart got a 2-hour-long ideological talk with Hitler about how to reintegrate the Dutch. This did not happen for Terboven. Anything like this only existed for the propaganda department, who were told, quote-unquote, to win over the Norwegians. From Quisling and Rosenberg's perspective, Hitler could have found no man worse than Terboven. Terboven was the antithesis to their romantic, idealistic, and often indirect personalities. The Reichskommissar's lack of cultural respect also showed itself in his literal first motion, which was picking the king's residence as his main place of stay in Norway. This resulted in a rather negative reaction by the Norwegian population. The same lack of sensitivity also showed itself in Terboven's first meeting with Quisling. The Reichskommissar was shocked at how imprecise Quisling worked. He lacked any financial records of the party, member numbers, and was weak in conversation and rhetoric. With Quisling being considered incapable by Terboven and being universally hated by the population, Terboven decided to drop Quisling and tried to cooperate with the big Norwegian conservative parties instead. His meeting with the administration council had a similar tone. He said he does not meet with them because he respects their role, but only to inform himself of their qualities. Meanwhile, Quisling panically wrote to Rosenberg, fearing his position. He admitted for the first time that he was aware of how much he was hated in the country, but with enough propaganda, he said he could turn this around. Terboven could stop this letter from reaching Hitler and met with him on the 7th of May. He returned to Norway with new confidence and removed all of Rosenberg's bureaucrats from the country. The main partner of Quisling was therefore outplayed. With his main competition out of the way, Terboven could begin his strategy of winning over the Norwegian population. His first speech to the public was supposed to calm the Norwegians down.
Das sind, ich betone es nochmals, innenpolitische Angelegenheiten der norwegischen Bevölkerung, in die ich mich nicht einzumischen wünsche und in denen ich niemand ein irgendwie geratetes Urteil aufnötigen will.
Norwegian prisoners of war were also released under the condition of signing an oath that they shall never raise their arms against Germany again. Officers were even allowed to keep their swords, and by the 10th of July, most soldiers could quickly return to their families, which, like in the Netherlands, probably was one of the best propaganda moves of the occupation. Meanwhile, Terboven was attempting small successes, Rosenberg had no interest in giving up on his men in Quisling, and got in contact with Hitler. Rosenberg told him how horribly Quisling was being treated. Hitler therefore called Terboven on the 21st of August and gave him orders that must have felt like an absolute shock.
Perbovin did not even expect to remain a Reichskommissar far longer, because under his strategy, Norway would stabilize enough to become independent. He then could return to his Gau in Essen, which was on the way to become one of the wealthiest areas in Europe. The reality looked different. Hitler told Terboven that he insists that Quisling was to be included in the new government, and that from the 29th of August, all parties besides the National Assembling shall be banned. This annihilated Terboven's strategy in one order. Quisling therefore achieved a success, and was for a very short time closer to Hitler than the Reichskommissar himself. The Norwegians therefore lost the chance for an internally independent country. Not even though of their racial closeness, but because of it. Hitler and Rosenberg wanted to bring Norway close to the Reich as quickly as possible, and in their opinion, this was only possible by a top-down domination through a single party. The new phase of the occupation began, with Quisling's party being the only political force in Norway. All ties with the royal family were cut. In Terboven's speech, he still stated, though, that Norway's freedom will only be partially restored. This led to one NS party member stating,
Om disse ordene virkelig betyr restriksjoner på vår nasjonale frihet, da vi virkelig de nasjonale forræderne som folket kaller oss.
This was not the official takeover of the government that Quisling so desired. He still was only the head of the State Commissars Council. But this already boosted the party into a new position of power. Terboven tried to restrict the party's growth by withholding money during his talks with the other parties. This changed now with all other parties being banned. The money led to the NS magazine Fritt Volk being able to have regular releases, and the membership numbers skyrocketed from 4,000 to 25,200 by the end of 1940. The numbers began to stagnate quickly though. Till the end of 1943, the height of the membership was reached with 43,400. For the general population, this power grab of Quisling and his first attempts to get control of society began the first acts of at least passive resistance. The NS demanded that the teachers' union swore an oath of loyalty to the NS. As a response, the teachers' union prepared a unified decline of this demand. And as soon as the NS got wind of this, they retreated this demand in fear of societal uproar. The next attempt was taking control of radio stations. Both Germany and NS began using the radio as a format to spread their ideology to the population. Pan-Germanic media was aired and advertising for the NS. The actors in response to this change went on strike. Opposed to this teachers' union, the NS did not retreat here, but this time simply handed down a ban on all participants from their job. While both of these groups were only a minority of society, the NS attempts to control the sports media was the first mass topic. The NS demanded that all sports organizations came under control of their party. The population, as a reaction, boycotted all events and games, and the famous athletes also stopped participating. The first steps of the NS to control society therefore failed in every area. Quisling's party was simply too disliked by the average population to find any mass appeal. Some conservatives stated even that they would rather have a full German occupation than Quisling's rule. That the pan-Germanic attempts and ideology could only come through National Sammlung therefore destroyed every ability of pan-Germanism finding any positive reception among the population. Therefore, analyzing the reception of pan-Germanism among the general population would seem rather trivial. Also, most sources and internal statistics are still not published till today. Therefore, to keep researching the pan-Germanic elements of the occupation, one has to look into minority groups. The SS already allowed the recruitment of non-German Germanics by 1929. Concerted efforts to recruit in Norway, because of the political instability caused after the invasion between the King, Quisling and Terboven, were delayed till the beginning of 1941. For Quisling, the recruitment of Norwegians for the war was in no way a surrendering of his national sovereignty. In his idea, this was the first step of rebuilding the Norwegian army. He began meeting with Norwegian officers for planning.
The service was supposed to happen in Finland. The fact that Quisling was aware of how unpopular Pan-Germanic propaganda in Germany was is shown by the advertising. Pan-Germanic language is avoided, the focus is on anti-communism and helping the Finnish friends. The Norwegian Legion was supposed to get the Norwegian officers, uniforms and training in their own country. The plan was to recruit 20 to 30,000 men. In the end, Quisling was able to recruit 1,200. With this failure, the TSS took over. The volunteers in the end got German uniforms training by German officers in Prussian tradition and were trained in Germany and swore their oath of loyalty to Adolf Hitler. Even though every promise was broken, some volunteers still came in. Till 1945, 5,000 SS men volunteered to fight alongside Germany from Norway. One of the only successes Quisling could achieve at the time was that the 500 ski troops actually got Norwegian officers and were deployed in Finland. Statistics on these volunteers are hard to research and rather unclear. Supposedly 50% of the volunteers came from quote-unquote unsatisfactory family conditions. The majority came from the conservative urban centers of cities like Oslo and Trondheim. To appeal to the more rural population, 20 to 30 hectares of farmland with Slavic Serbs were promised in the coming Ostimperium. The training of the volunteers was more complicated than expected from the German side. Many officers humiliated the Norwegian volunteers and insulted their national pride, often by accident. Many Prussian officers simply did not know enough about the North to adjust to their identity. The officers saw the Norwegians as weak men, softened by European small statery. On the other hand, the Norwegian volunteers saw the Prussian militarism and collectivism as almost Asiatic. When Himmler found out about these troubles, he showed no reluctance to act. He sent every German officer who trained these troops to a 14-day schooling about Norway and the history of the North so they could adjust to their volunteers. In his opinion, German arrogance could threaten the entire Pan-Germanic project. In Fritt Volk, the strategy was that the volunteers were supposed to learn Pan-Germanic thought through the service at the front lines and then spread them when coming back to their homeland.
Unge nordmenn som elsker sitt fedreland skal i denne avdelingen bli oppdratt til gode soldater og stridmenn. De skal dra tilbake til sitt hjemland som forkjemper for den storgermanske tanke og hjelpe sitt folk til å oppnå den plass et selvbevisst medlem av det nye europeiske fellesskap har krav på.
The quotes not only show a radical pan-germanism, but also hope that Norway will have a sovereign place in the coming European order. Some of them did fully embrace the pan-germanic ideology, though.
Det germanske folket må stå sammen om de ønsker å kunne etablere det vi kaller europeisk kultur og flytte den fremover.
These SS people represented an absolute minority, though. Even in the NS, the average member wanted a sovereign Norway. The exception would be Jonas Lee, head of the police and head author of the SS close paper Germanerin. He led the hard pan-Germanic wing in the NS, but stayed unpopular in the party, besides for the actual members and volunteers of the SS. The first tests of Telboven's ability to deal with dissidents in Norway happened on the 4th of March 1941. As an act of sabotage happened in the north of Norway, in collaboration between parts of the civilian population and the English government. In response, Terboven only gave the community who participated a hefty monetary punishment, and a few Norwegians who escaped back with the English got their houses burnt down. Much more was also not possible by the legal restrictions Terboven was under. This changed on the 31st of July, when he allowed the death penalty to be handed down by German military courts against Norwegian civilians. Armed resistance stayed basically non-existent till 1943 and was always rather trivial. The majority of resistance happened through strikes and passive social acts. The reason for those can be undeniably seen less by some vague form of Norwegian idealism, but because their real living standards went radically down. The real wages of the average Norwegian between 1940 and October 1941 went down by 30%. This combined with the requisitions of alcohol, coffee and other quote-unquote luxury items did not help the German reputation. Hagelin stated around this time,
Om Wehrmacht ville sabotere arbeidet til nationalistene, da kan de ikke finne noe bedre middel enn plutselig erklære nødsituasjoner og forlange unødvendige rekvisjoner.
These shortages and requisitions led to a boiling point, when an industrial plant, Ackers Mechanische Werkstatt, the union-mandated morning milk got removed from their free meals. The workers revolted. This time, with the legal means on Terboven's side, he could act as he wanted. The two union leaders were quickly executed. From the Wehrmacht, this was seen as unnecessary. Also, the pan-Germanic idealism of the SS and the military can sadly not be seen here by the SS that is responsible for the police services. SS Sturmbannführer Werner Knaap was supposed to aid in dealing with those strikes. When a worker said they couldn't work without their milk, he lost it and screamed out how they were doing better than workers in Germany and finished his rant with, "You are getting shot and the others will be deported to Germany." Quisling, as a supposed representative of the Norwegians, had no interest in calming the situation down, but instead used it as a means to gain power from Hitler. He claimed that if Terboven would have just acted harsher and earlier, all this could have been prevented. The combination of criticism from the Wehrmacht, Hitler, who thought he lost control of the country, Quisling, and the unrest of the population led to Terboven being frustrated with the situation. On the 9th of September 1941, he finally broke and said,
Die Ereignisse sind mir nicht unerwünscht. Ich bin den Norwegern vergebens nachgelaufen. Jetzt will ich sie in die Knie zwingen.
With Terboven steadily losing face in Norway and among the Nazi Party, Quisling used this as a means to expand his power. On the 1st of February 1942, Quisling finally became the official head of state in Norway. But in the reality of the occupation, this made no real structural change. He was further completely under Terboven's control. The Grand Parade and independence announcements were ignored by the larger populace too. Quisling specifically requested that Terboven, in his speech about Quisling's head of state title, should include how this is the last step before official independence. Terboven ignored this. It is difficult to find any more traces of a peaceful occupation further at this point. Hitler received a letter from Bormann, which included a research conducted by the Nazis in Norway. Quisling was supposedly hated by 95% of the population. Quisling therefore lost with this even support from Hitler. The NS also tried a changed propaganda. They switched from grand pan-Germanic paroles to their own patriotic aesthetics like Vikings. The results were trivial and contradictory at best. The German occupiers were left confused in this sudden switch, and the general Norwegian population did not care at all. The strategy therefore was no more a propaganda attempt, but direct influence by taking control of societal structures and organizations. The NS also felt used by the German occupiers. Hagelin, Quisling's right-hand man from the start of the occupation, confronted him in April of 1943.
Vi som eksponenter av Norges nasjonale bevegelse, vi som jobber for Norges frihet og uavhengighet, kan ikke lenger forsvare argumentet foran det norske folk, hvis interesser vi forlanget til å beskytte, til å jobbe sammen med Reichskommissariat når de erklærer at det politiske målet å eliminere Norges frihet og uavhengighet.
The resistance remained passive though. The government in exile also recommended passive resistance. Understanding the futility of armed resistance and the danger it would bring upon the nation through retaliation. The first grand violence erupted when in June 1943, 35,000 men were supposed to be drafted for forced labor. The draft and execution of this was supposed to be done by the NS themselves and its paramilitary, the Hood. Of the 35,000 men, 3,000 men were actually drafted. Even with this failure, the resistance radicalized and decided to blow up the labor office and supported escape structures were built, which allowed young men to escape to the rural areas. How little control the NS had over culture shows itself in the university crisis. In November of 1943, when total war was already declared, the university bureaucrats still felt they had enough freedom to ignore orders that the NS members were supposed to be admitted without checking their grade cards required for their degree. The result was that the German occupiers had to step in, and mass arrests began and brutal repressions from Terboven. Hitler, with his limited knowledge of the detailed situation, blamed Terboven for his lack of precision and bad propaganda effects this had on all Germanic peoples. With the end of the war slowly becoming a reality, even for radical ideologues, the occupation changed one last time. Quisling began to fully submit himself to Hitler by 1944. Meanwhile, Terboven had the freedom to be as brutal as he pleased by this point. Inner party battles broke out in the NS between the hard pan-Germanic wing of Jonas Lee, the National Patriotic Wing of Hagelin, and Quisling's wing, which was primarily about Quisling himself. Quisling's statement of full submission to Hitler in the early days of 1944 did not help the split inside the party.
Jeg kan forsikre deg, Führer, at Norge til en konstant økende grad vil bli bevist om sitt germanske og europeiske ansvar og villig til å forplikte seg helt til dette.
Roald Dyster, a prominent NS figure in a speech, blamed Quisling mid-1944 for all failures of the occupation. This led to Quisling using German secret police to have him arrested and fully establishing himself as the sole figure of the party. Meanwhile, death penalties were handed down left and right in Oslo. Of 32 trials, of 160 accused, 127 were given the death penalty. With the advance of the Red Army, the Finnmark was supposed to be fully made into scorched earth. 50,000 people were supposed to flee by the order of the Reichskommissar. When this did not happen, the Germans' forces forced the evacuation and even as pleased to at least accommodate and adjust to the few German-friendly groups were ignored. Quisling's last visit with Hitler on the 17th of January 1945 led to Quisling awakening to his meaninglessness in the end of the war. Hitler allowed no mention of Norwegian independence in any way. On the third anniversary of the NS government, neither Quisling or Terboven even showed up anymore. Meanwhile, Jonas Lee, the leader of the Pan-Germanic and SS wing of the party, declared preparation for civil war in Norway after the war. The NS, statistically, could have manned up to 12,000 young men. In reality, only 300 volunteered to protect Quisling's home. Meanwhile, Terboven and Quisling suggested a Germanic Ragnarok in Norway to retreat from Germany and to hold out in the Germanic Urheimat. These ideas were not seen as favorable by Hitler and considered insane by the generals. After Hitler's death, Dönitz symbolically removed Terboven as the Reichskommissar. Terboven's cold and pragmatic personality accepted his resignation and had no hopes for his chances after the war. He decided to take his life with a dynamite stick. With his favorite drink, an English crime novel, he entered his office in the Norwegian king's residence for the last time, and with an explosion, his service in Norway ended. The occupation of Norway did not know what it wanted to be. For the military and Terboven, it was supposed to just be a typical, stable occupation. Therefore, all their motivations for their actions were for stability, and in the end, for the war. On the other side, you had ideologues in both the NSDAP and the National Sammling who aspired to use the war for their political goals. The resulting clash of this showed itself in acts of Hitler and therefore in the occupation of Norway itself. You can take from this occupation whatever you want, but we can clearly see that an attempt was made here. The results of this were clearly not successful though, but why? If you look at the closest comparison, the Netherlands and Denmark, this failure can be analyzed more productively. In the Netherlands, we see that the positive attempts that were made had positive receptions, but again, the realities of the war made such further attempts impossible. In the Netherlands, I would say Pan-Germanism was possible if the war was won, even though these hypotheticals are of course only of limited value. In Norway, these attempts had even less reception than in the Netherlands, so why even try this domination to begin with? Why not a grassroots attempt? For that, we can look at Denmark. Denmark stayed internally independent up until 1943 with the tide of the war. Denmark had extremely low reception of National Socialism during their internally independent time, with only 2% of the vote during their peak. So from this perspective, it can be understood why Hitler wanted ideological influence with his demand of having Quisling in the government. Because even with German hegemony over Europe, it became clear that a pan-Germanic identity did not instantly pop out of the ground. It also just had bad timing. An idea of patriotism in Norway was strong, but it did not root from the same form of nationalism as Germany, but in their recent independence from a country even closer to them than Germany, with their separation from Sweden only 40 years before. With the political stability, the patriotic history of Norway, and the lack of geopolitical conflict threatening Norway, the idea of a hard pan-Germanic nationalism had no incentives besides some vague form of anti-communism for the average person. In the end, if the war would have turned out on the side of Germany, these experiments would have probably slowly over decades turned positive. But while looking at the historical facts of the matter, it failed. These topics should, because of this failure, not be forgotten though. They are forgotten by people who care more about the violent parts of the war, I guess because they are more interesting for headlines and titles, but they are also badly researched by the local historians, who only really care about the side of the resistance. In the context of Norway at least, it took up until the late and early 90s for any research to begin on positive collaboration in Norway. Let's hope this video gives at least some of you motivation to research the occupation of the Germanic countries yourself. Thanks to everyone who helped me with this video. Special thanks to the people who helped me find sources and books and everything else I need. Double thanks to everybody who helped me read quotes, and to the Norwegian people who were extremely friendly and helped me with local sources. Takke spesielt til det norske som hjalp meg med skittatene og kildene. And with these words, I wish you all a happy quote-unquote new year, and thanks for watching.